I'm Mohammed Bhuyan with the Innovation and Entrepreneurship Program here. And this afternoon we have a very impressive group of speakers and participants.
It is a privilege to introduce Dr. Leonard Schlesinger, the 11th president of Babson College. Had a chance to meet Leonard just yesterday, last evening in fact, and it was quite a privilege because I think arguably Babson is the best known college for entrepreneurship in the country. And if I didn't know that beforehand, I certainly knew it after talking to Leonard last night. But he brings a certain unique skill set. He is not only an academic, but he's also been an executive officer, the chief operating officer for Limited Brands. His resume is in the book. And I will just say once again that it is a privilege to have you, Leonard, today. And if you would join me in a welcome, warm welcome, OFC welcome to Dr. Schlesinger.
Thank you, Bill. And thank you for inviting me to this session here today. What I'd like to do is actually build on Chancellor Davis's comments and then take them down into the microscope of one single institution that I'll talk about all the caveats on an a priori basis about what makes us different. I'll talk a little bit about where I think there's some lessons that are available to all of you in the context, and then I'll allow us to throw it open for a much broader discussion. But I am quite honored to be here. Let me tell you a little bit about Babson College. One of the things that Bill talked about was, after talking to me, at least he knew that we were the number one school in entrepreneurship at the undergraduate level for 14 years, at the graduate level for 18 years, and a leading school for entrepreneurship education in the world. And he knows that because virtually nobody knows about Babson outside of that community. And so I am also the president and the chief marketing officer. The school was founded in 1919 as an institute for the less than totally bright, wealthy young white men who were the sons of Roger Babson's economic forecasting clients. And it was a 9-month institute that was designed to actually educate them enough in business to not be an embarrassment to the family. They had to wear a coat and tie to come to school. They got a secretary. They punched in, they punched out, and they got a dictaphone. And in the entrepreneurial zeal of Roger Babson at that point, he charged 3 times Harvard's tuition in 1919 because he believed it was 3 times more valuable. So where are we today? Now, 92 years later, we have 1,956 undergraduates from 74 countries. We are about 26% students of color. We're about 26% non-US by point of application, 40% non-US by passport, as I said before, from 74 different countries. We're a tuition-dependent institution, so we operate with what in the grand scheme of things is a sizable endowment of $235 million, but in the context of our competitors in New England, virtually infinitesimal in terms of those that we compete for students with. We are, despite being tuition dependent, we are need blind, have been need blind for over a decade, will continue to be committed to being need blind, and resolve our financial issues in 2 ways. One is 86% of all of our financial support of students comes out of the operating budget. So I'm fond in our community of saying we are one of the most intentionally diverse academic communities in higher education. And by intentionally diverse, I mean we pay for it. The second piece of that is that we're unable to meet full need given the limitations that we have. And so we do operate with meeting somewhere between 93 and 95% of FSAS need, as exemplified by students. And so we're always dealing with the extraordinary difficulties of trying to gap students and figure out how to get them into the institution. Despite all of those things, and the numbers kind of coming off of Chancellor Davis's elucidation of the numbers in the Georgia system, our first year retention rate for the last decade has been 97.5%. Our four-year retention rate has us as the number one college in small to medium-sized colleges among private institutions in the United States at 89% in 4 years and 97% in 6 years. And it puts us as the number five among all private colleges in the United States. And so I suggest there must be something going on here because there are schools that are substantially wealthier than us, schools like Harvard and Northwestern and Wesleyan, who don't come close to these retention rates. So are we doing something and is there something to learn from it? So how do we achieve this retention rate and how do we achieve our graduation rates? And how does it link to actually being an institution that is committed to entrepreneurship? And I'm going to argue here that the two are in fact closely related. That by encouraging and supporting entrepreneurial activity of all kinds among our student body, it goes a long way towards explaining our very high retention rates. So let me walk through that. The first issue, and it goes beyond the goal setting that the Chancellor articulated before, I would say for the leadership of Babson College, it's a moral commitment to doing whatever we can do to make sure that our students succeed. Okay? To make sure that our students get through and to make sure that our students succeed. We believe, and we're quite clear about saying this, if you bring people into your community, you in fact do have a moral obligation to partner with them in every way possible to get them to succeed. Now, partnering doesn't mean accepting poor performance. So we're also quite serious about dealing very quickly with performance problems in the first year. We intervene early and we intervene often in the first semester, and we have absolutely no problems whatsoever actually inviting people to do something else with their time after their first semester. And I'll talk a little bit about that and how we manage that process, because I think it's part of the equation that sends a signal to the broader student population that yes, we are committed, but it's a joint commitment. So given the demographics of the population I talked about at the school, there are a couple of other things to understand inside the institution. We're the only business school in the United States that's a member of the POSSE program that identifies high potential high school students with academic and leadership capabilities from inner cities who would otherwise be overlooked in the admission process. We've been a POSSE partner now. This is our eighth year. We pay out of our operating budget all of the costs of 10 to 12 students a year that come from New York City. It is the best financial investment I believe I've ever been involved in making in the institution. The ability of that student body to have a profound impact on the Babson community is incalculable and just mind-boggling in terms of its response. 70% of the POSSE students end up being material student leaders. And we have only lost one POSSE student in 8 years who hasn't graduated. It has taught us a lot. Now, retention obviously starts with the admission process, identifying and admitting the right students for our school. And we're blessed, obviously, with the process of going out there and selling the institution in all sorts of settings. And our applicant pool has increased dramatically over the last 3 years, 48% increase in the last 36 months. And so we're now at about 5,100 applications for roughly 450 to 460 spots. And we actually enjoy the benefit of being a focused niche school. People know what we do. We're very clear about what we do and what we don't do. If you're not interested in business and you're not interested in entrepreneurship, we're pretty good about telling you that somehow your bus stopped at the wrong station. And so our retention rate obviously starts with the folks we bring in and that what they know what they're coming for. We also ensure that we have a critical mass of students along lots of different socioeconomic and cultural dimensions. The most striking thing that jumps out at new community members, and this is based on the essays and the feedback we get from our first year class, is no matter whether they're from the US, people of color, international, or whatever their socioeconomic situation is, they can find other people like them at Babson. Nobody perceives that they are left out entirely by themselves. And we work to do that very hard. Work very hard to do that. We also believe that once you're enrolled, you need to have a great support network. And that starts from the first day students arrive on campus with what we call the first year seminar. And it sounds strikingly like the learning community that Chancellor Davis was talking about for the Georgia system. These seminar classes are once a week for the first semester of school, and they last an hour and 15 minutes. And each of these classroom sessions focuses on a distinct topic about transitioning to college life: academic adjustments, social adjustments, and lifestyle adjustments. So we cover a wide variety of topics in the course that we think are tightly linked to retention. Every single first-year student in the first-year seminar works with an upper-level student. Right? And those upper-level students are entirely voluntary, entirely volunteers. They're chosen by application, and they're very well-trained. In addition to an upper-level student mentor, there's a faculty member who's involved in the course, and there's a staff member. So there is a student mentor, a faculty member, and a staff member for a group of 15 students. They also meet regularly outside of class, and they have discussions that are designed for self-exploration. If the students feel isolated in any way, they can reach out to any of those three mentors assigned to their team. And guess what? Despite the quality and the skill of staff and the quality and the skill of faculty, students always tend to approach the upper class person first. These upper classmen, as I said, volunteer and apply. And it is the leadership and growth opportunity of being a mentor that attracts them. And it yields a trickle-down effect. Those kids are invested in the college, and those kids are actively invested in making sure that those who are coming behind them are equally invested. And what this creates for the first-year student is not only a source of motivation, but a safety net, which obviously is incredibly important for the first semester, the first 15 weeks of the year. This costs us virtually nothing. All the faculty that teach in that program volunteer. All the staff that teach in that program volunteer. All the students that mentor in that program volunteer. Costs us not one dime. Now, as I said earlier, a very small percentage of students have significant problems keeping up with the academics, and about 2%, are suspended for academic reasons after the first semester. We actually spend more time with the students we kick out of school than we spend with the ones we actually keep in. We work with each of them when we actually suspend them from the institution on a personalized plan, defining what they're going to be doing when they're off campus, where they're going to go. If they choose other institutions in the Boston area, we work with them on the specific choice of the institution, the specific choice of courses, and set very clear targets for them, academically and personally, for them to return to school to resume their studies. And obviously, after that semester, they have to actually document the performance against their learning plan and also their own personal kind of leadership plan as they think about coming back to the institution. The overwhelming majority of the first-year students who were suspended return, and they have a graduation rate of roughly 75% over the 4 years. If you want to go into more detail, we can discuss that in the Q&A. But the first-year seminar is not just about retention. There's a more ambitious goal. It's not just for those who are going to fall through the cracks, but also for those who are achieving and connecting more. And this makes that first semester a richer experience. How else do we try to deal with that? We not only try to build the connections among the students, but also with the faculty and the staff. We know the research that supports the notion if students feel connected, they're likely to be engaged and stay in the institution. So all of that work goes on around the first year. We also actively use social media like Twitter, discussion boards, blogs, and Facebook. We do a lot of that before students arrive on campus, so it's easier to maintain an online dialogue. From an entrepreneurial perspective, there are many ways to get creative about what we do online. And to be perfectly honest, we're figuring it all out ourselves. Sometimes things work, and sometimes things don't. And my suggestion to you is to think small as you start out in this space. We also create a campus environment where there are lots of leadership opportunities. We are fond of saying we teach entrepreneurship and we live entrepreneurship every day. Students plan all of their own conferences, they reach out to alumni and others for resources, they get speakers, and they draw on professionals from greater Boston and beyond. Again, most of these ventures are enormously successful, but even if they're not, the student organizers learn how to make those events better next time. I believe personally that co-curricular activity is the safest place in college to try and make something happen. If you don't succeed, you just try again, and you're successful the next time. And quite honestly, the college environment is a much safer environment than the world outside. So my speech to parents when they're thinking about, you know, with a full tuition, quite honestly, of $53,000, tuition, room, and board, it's a very difficult sell on 14 hours a week. It just doesn't work. So my sell is we're actually 168 hours a week. There's 154 hours. Outside of class, that's 11 times more than the time spent in class. And as a residential college, we make that a major part of the asset base for managing retention. But again, even if you're not a residential school, I would argue the co-curricular activities are a very central part of building a feeling of being invested and valuing the total college experience. Finally, I believe, and we believe as an institution, you have to empower students to act and start things. And I don't mean just businesses. We do that all over the school. I mean clubs, organizations, and service projects of all kind. With only 2,000 students, we have almost 100 clubs and organizations that were started by our students, and that doesn't include 21 varsity athletic teams, and more than 50 student community service projects currently underway in Greater Boston. With student organizations, we want their great ideas to flourish, and we never say no to a good idea, even if we have no idea how it's going to be funded or supervised. Instead of saying no, we push it back on the students. Where are the resources going to come from? How are you going to make sure this activity is sustained and controlled? It's about taking an idea and allowing students to create a way of making it their idea and under control. So the point relative to the student staff, and this is my final point before I get gone, is it's this culture of empowerment that's really the critical differentiator of Babson. And for you to be able to do this, you need to completely shift the mindset from student service to student engagement, to a model that enables students to be deeply involved, not just in coming up with ideas, but in implementing those ideas. Every day we tell our staff and campus life, it is not your job to make it happen. It's your job to make it possible. It's up to the students to make their ideas happen. An entrepreneurial college is about teaching our students not just how to start businesses. It's about encouraging them to live entrepreneurially 24 hours a day. So yes, it does require a very conscious strategy. It requires a moral commitment from the top to the bottom, really thinking about first and foremost about how to create a stronger community and how to sustain it and make people part of it. We're always learning. And we're always trying to improve, because being entrepreneurial is by definition a work in progress. And I am thankful for the opportunity to share these thoughts with you today and look forward to engaging with you on how to make them even better.
Thank you. We are now open for questions, and the ground rule for the questions is the maximum time to ask question is 30 seconds. And both of the panelists will have 1 minute to respond. That is the maximum time, so that more people can ask questions. So if you raise your hand, I'll recognize you. Dr. Anderson, Dr. Malvo, and Dr. Rahman, and Dr. Gilbert.
Chancellor Davis.
Roshan.
Chancellor Davis, you mentioned that many of the institutions in your system have minority male programs or some equivalent to that. Could you talk a little bit about how well they're doing?
As I tried to imply, they're doing quite well. They've received not only funding from the state, which I have maintained, but they also, last year, for example, attracted a $500,000 Lumina grant. This is administered centrally, but the people put in proposals. It's competitive, and there's awards made for the programs. And as I said, over the last 10 years, it's gone up by 68%, and so we're pretty happy. I'd like to have more money, though.
So are they increasing first to second year retention, 4 year graduate, et cetera, significantly, or at least incrementally in a way that you feel good about?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I don't have that statistic right here with me, but again, the number that we are attracting and keeping in school has gone up significantly.
Colleagues, I bring you greetings from Bennett College for Women, the oasis where we educate and celebrate women and develop them into 21st century leaders and global thinkers, and I still have 20 seconds. President Schlesinger, entrepreneurship...
Marker to my own heart.
Entrepreneurship, leadership, global studies, and communications are part of our curricular transformation. And I'm interested in the co-curricular activities that you've had for students around entrepreneurship. What kinds of things have students done outside the classroom with entrepreneurship that some of us could learn from?
Sure. Every single leadership conference on campus throughout the academic year is entirely managed by students. Our staff, you know, might run a little bit of interference, might do a little bit of helping them around the budget process, but the Student Government Association and Individual Initiative and Students has now set a year after year tradition, much like you, Dr. Bjorn, in terms of every year having to be better than the year before, of having bigger and better conferences, bigger and better activities. The community, the Bernin Center for Community Service has become a haven for lots of students who want to move beyond the bucolic splendor of Wellesley into the broader Boston community. And again, they're very active in identifying the activities they want to be engaged in and the ways in which they want to engage in it. Finally, as a business school and committed to entrepreneurship, half of our first year course is oriented towards actually starting up a business in groups of 16 and taking it through the entire process, the life cycle of a business, and they're actually just shutting them down this week. We stake every group of 16 with $3,000 of institutional funds to steward during the academic year. You know, now after 15 years, we're still dollars ahead. And it is a profound transformational experience for students in terms of getting them off their rear end and into kind of doing things.
Thank you. Dr. Rahman?
There is one white elephant in the room. We spend enormous amount of time talking about retention of the students and graduation. Yet the recent study shows that 35% of the students don't learn much in the first 2 years of college. And then 45% or so don't learn a whole lot. So I was wondering what Chancellor Davis or Dr. Tatum have any comments on those points, you know, since they run two different kind of schools.
I have recently seen that. Matter of fact, I have that article in my bag right now. I am not yet prepared to sign up for the fact that our students don't learn anything in the first 2 years. We have two-year liberal arts transfer institutions, and I'm pretty sure that those moving from those institutions into our four-year institutions have to meet certain expectations and barriers before they get in. So they're teaching the same core everywhere. So I remain unconvinced until I can sort of deconstruct that article.
I'm equally unconvinced about the methodology, but actually do celebrate that in that same article, we got highlighted as the aberrational difference and one of the 10 schools that where people do learn things.
The reason I'm asking, I know Dr. Puya is looking at me, is, you go, yes, may I ask this?
Sure.
I am a trustee of a liberal arts college, which is a first-rate liberal arts college, Austin College. Then I also work with the State University, Angeles State University. So we deal with these things. Those reports, when they come out, we don't inspire too much confidence in public. I wrote a small op-ed piece for Dallas Morning News, and I think I gave it to Dr. Bui. I don't know if he read it or not. He's got too many important things to read. And it sort of opened a hornet's nest, and a lot of people reacted very strongly. Some said this is not right, and some said schools are not doing anything.
Okay.
So I don't think we can dismiss that kind of report. You know?
Well, that's why I said, you know, the focus is increasingly on outputs, not on inputs.
Okay. Next question was from Dr. Gilbert Rochon.
Given the anticipated negative impact of the Pell Grants and other sources of funds being no longer available and their impact on student summer research, on entrepreneurship, on athletics, on a host of other community engagement initiatives, what other alternative sources of funding have you identified in order to maintain such programs?
What I have done is that my presidents, many of them, I shouldn't say all because I have some in the room, want to raise tuition from point A to point B. And the argument is always to be competitive with one's peer group, and everybody has a set of peers and aspirational peers, which are unique by institution. And the ground rule I've been using, particularly with the research ones who want to raise more quickly than others, is if you want to go from point A to point B, you must raise and provide need-based aid for every student that's on Pell, and I know the percentage of your students that are on Pell, and I don't want to see that percentage go down next year either. So if you want at Georgia Tech to raise your tuition by $1,000, then that has to be really indifferent to those students who are on Pell, because you will provide that through privately raised funding, and they are meeting those challenges.
Next question was from Dr. Willie Gilchrist, then we'll have Dr. Rivers, and then Dr. Freeman.
I don't know whether either one of you could give us the numbers, but it would be interesting to know what your minimum criteria to enter into your institutions based on SAT or ACT and or GPA.
In this class of 5,100 applicants, the one we're just going through right now, the average SAT score for the two sections, not the three, just crossed 1,300, and grade point average is 3.65.
Is that on two parts of the SAT?
Two parts.
Our system has 35 different schools. They have 35 different entrance requirements. They range from at Georgia Tech, the SAT is approaching 1,400, and the high school GPA is like 3.95 for the entire freshman body, down to those institutions where, quite frankly, the requirement is that you fog the mirror.
It's amazing.
Dr. Schlesinger, I want to follow up on the question that Dr. Gilchrist raised. I understand that you've gotten 5,300 applications.
5,100, yeah.
51, and you select about 400?
450 to 460, yeah.
So you can select perhaps the best of the best. Doesn't it make it a little easier for you to deal with progression, retention, and graduation rates?
Oh, no question. No, it's not. There's nothing accusatory about it. It's just an empirical fact. But the reality of it is, as I said earlier, even when you compare us to institutions that have much higher levels of selectivity, in the Ivies, for example, we still do much better than them on 1 year and 4 year retention rates.
Where do you see the difference in terms of doing better than your peers?
Well, I think the issue in terms of doing better with our peers is almost entirely around the management of that first year experience.
Thank you.
Dr. Freeman.
Yes, I won't direct the question to Chancellor Davis, since this is the second time I've had the chance to hear him today. I heard him earlier in Macon, and he did a good job there and here. But I would like to ask our colleague from Babson a question about outputs. You obviously have the best of the best graduates. We've just gone through one of the worst economic meltdowns worldwide. Could you walk us through what interventions your graduates have had in creating the situation and ameliorating the situation
in
the economic situations around the world?
In terms of their responsibility for creating it?
That's correct.
Okay. So it's a marvelous...
Let me help on the question.
No, I answer the question all the time. It's a marvelous red herring question. because it goes back to the essential argument that MBAs ruled the world and ruined it. And there are not enough of them to actually have that level of a profound impact. So if you want to deal with the fundamental issue, and I'll deal with it in under a minute, the fundamental issue associated with the global meltdown, but most particularly starting in the United States financial institutions, there are two fundamental questions that have been asked largely by the commentators. Were we stupid, okay, or were we greedy? And my answer is always, why do you have to choose? It's quite obvious to us we were both. Now, do institutions actually play a role in that? There is no question that there's a fundamental belief structure in parts of classical economics and parts of classical finance, okay, that assume the capacity to be able to make predictions about events that, in fact, they're not capable of doing. So that's number one. So there are natural limitations to the conceptual knowledge that we teach in the school. Do I want to take personal responsibility for having shaped a collection of people who acted unethically in the broader universe? No, I don't want to do that. Do I believe that we have an opportunity to surface more fundamental issues and have more concrete discussions in the institution? The answer is, yeah, I believe we do. Do I believe that teaching another course in Kantian philosophy is somehow going to change people's fundamental ethical structure? The answer is no. So our commitment at Babson is around a program that we've actually developed called Giving Voice to Values, that essentially says most people know the difference between right and wrong, particularly on the macro issues. And what they don't know how to do is how to take a stand and how to practice actually doing it in real time. And so we're focused entirely on the capacity to build those muscles and those practice skills that enable people to actually rehearse taking ethical stands and working their ethical voice in a profound way, under the assumption that practice is actually going to increase the likelihood that when you face a real situation, you're going to actually be able to do the right thing. Thanks.
I'm going to take a minute on that one, if you don't mind. Let me give you the non-educational view of that question. I think you cannot look at the value system that a 21 or 22 or 24-year-old kid comes out of with a textbook education, and in some cases an expectation of how much money they're going to make, because the first thing that anybody does when they get them is they retrain them. So the institutions that are really training and retraining and have ethics and value systems in hand are really those institutions. You can call it Wall Street, you can call it big business. I get the question probably more than you get it, about, you know, all CEOs are greedy or we're all stupid or yes, all of the above. And I just reject it out of hand. I think an institution, for example, our institution, can focus on values and doing, not only measuring output, but measuring how you get the output. And I think that's where the system failed. Is the measurement of output is great, but missing in most of the institutions on Wall Street and in a lot of cases in corporate America is the measurement of not only what you do, but how did you do it. And as long as you put that into the value system and the training up front, I think that you can succeed that way. And I think the educational system brings people in with certain sets of values and can influence that behavior, but the training and the regulation is on the business community, not on the education systems.
Thank you, Mr. West. Next question from Dr. Howard Vittal, and then followed by Dr. Melvin Johnson.
Okay, I guess I would like to go the opposite direction on the wealth in terms of retention. Even though I don't know the exact research, but I could probably guess what it's going to demonstrate or what it has demonstrated. But I'm interested in what retention strategies tend to work from families or students from families who are first generation and who are at the opposite end, who can't pay $53,000 a year to go to college.
Yep. So
I'd like to speak to that, please, if I might, because we have a lot of students in that category at Spelman. And one of the things that we are doing is a program, a mentorship program, specifically targeted for first-generation students, which involves upper-class first-generation students being paired in a sort of big sister arrangement with entering first-generation students. Because there are issues, of course, that all students face, but there's some that are more challenging, not just from an economic point of view, but just not knowing the ins and outs of college that you get if you come from a family that has attended college. And so we have found that this partnering relationship between older first generation and younger first generation students is very helpful as it relates to retention. Certainly, funding is really critical, and we are not positioned like Babson is to meet 90 or even 95% of the need. We meet about 25 or 30% of the need that our students have demonstrated need. So obviously filling in that gap is huge, but we have found that focused fundraising in that regard has been helpful, particularly since 2008, where we have really been focused on a kind of each one, reach one method to keep students in school, particularly in the junior, senior year. And close to 1,000 students have benefited from what we call our President's Safety Net Fund to be able to finish their education that might not otherwise have been able to.
Mr. Davis, if you want to jump on that and follow up.
I agree exactly with the model that there is, relying on upperclassmen who are also first-generation students in that formal mentorship role to play that role. Again, I have the advantage now of 8 years of Posse. 100% of the Posse participants are first-generation college, and we learned enormously from them and the support network that the Posse Foundation has created for them that we can actually begin to translate to others on campus.
Yeah, I really don't have a lot to add to either what my colleague said, other than our focus is to get students more engaged through any number of mechanisms, and we find that the higher the level of engagement with the school, the higher the probability that they will graduate regardless of the financial circumstances. If they are engaged, they will find a way, and we will help them find a way to stay in school.
The last question for this part would be from Dr. Melvin Johnson.
Thank you very much. I want to really congratulate all of the participants. You've come with some very specific ideas to address this problem. However, I'm a little concerned about the linking of the accountability issues to the problem directly in terms of top-down accountability, based upon the fact that there's a term structure issue in terms of when the intervention is taken and when the results are actually noticed. You talk about 6-year rates in most cases, you know, so the intervention that you provide today may not be seen until 6 years from hence. So how do you deal with that problem, that term structure problem?
Well, you make an excellent point, which I might add when you're answering questions is what you say when you're sort of formulating the answer still in your mind. One of the points we wanted to make is we wanted to have some assurance that attention was being paid, that programs did exist, and certainly retention is not a 6-year issue. Retention is an annual issue, and so graduation rates are a lagging indicator. By the time you look at a graduation rate, it's too late to do anything. And so we want more predictive indicators of performance. And obviously, we can't tell someone in year one of the program, we don't like your graduation rate and you're going to get your salary slashed. I mean, we're dumb but not stupid. Again, we also tailor the programs to the school. And they're mutually agreed upon. The seminal point is that we want every president to know that we are really serious about this and that we expect them to do what is necessary to assure student success, and they will all have a unique set of students and methodologies they use.
Thank you, Mr. Davis.